Forgiving friends, we come before the Lord to worship and glorify Him during this Friday evening service. Let us praise God for this opportunity that God has given to us to get connected with Him and to share the Word of God and also to worship Him. Let us be quiet for a while, feeling the presence of God in our midst. They are confined to our homes, but God's presence is there with us. Lord Jesus, your time and the day was done. You met your friends at the evening time. Come, Lord Jesus. You took him to Jerusalem, but you came with determination, with tasks to be done. Come, Lord Jesus. You came to show us the way of a humble king, a serving Lord, to be the crucified one, and to show us how to live. Come, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, you too enjoyed when night drew on, to tell your tales in the close of the day. Come, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, you kindled faith when lamps were low. You opened scriptures, broke bread, and shed their light as darkness fell. Come, Lord Jesus. May we now read responsively the Psalm 51, 1 to 17. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. Surely, I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Surely, you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones we have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will turn back to you. Save me from blood guilt, O God. The God who saves me, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, all I will bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of God and a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart of God, you will not despise. Let us spend some time in silence, seeking God's forgiveness, because we know that we have gone astray from God. And we have committed sins against our fellow human beings. We have also done greater mistakes and wrongdoings against the beautiful creation of God. In our silent prayers, let us come before the Lord, confessing our sins. Almighty God, this is a hard time. The focus of Lent is on the pain and suffering of Jesus and our own need for penitence. It is a time of gathering darkness, but we would rather skip this part and go straight to Easter. We would rather ignore the suffering in you and in the world and avoid the hard work of true self-examination. Forgive us for wanting this season to be bright, painless and easy, when we know that Jesus did not take the easy way, but chose the path of the cross. Teach us the true meaning of penitence, so that we use this Lenten season to humbly seek a pain heart and in your spirit. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. The truth is this: God's love and mercy are never ending. God knows us in our inward being. God cleanses us from our sins and shortcomings and restores to us the joy of salvation. Amen. Thanks be to God. We will now have the scripture reading.
Hear the word of God as it is written in the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 18, verses 33 to 38. John chapter 18, reading from verse 33. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus and asked him, "I am the king of the Jews." "Is that your own idea?" Jesus asked. "Or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "It was your people and your chief priests who handed you over to me. What is it you have done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You are right in saying I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of the truth listens to me." "What is the truth?" Pilate asked. With this he went out again to the Jews and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him." Here ends the reading. Thanks be to him.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, as you know, we have been meditating upon the different themes with the question, "Why are you there?" The questions along with this are also Jesus asking the other people and others posing questions to Jesus. During this season of Lent, we have been meditating upon different aspects. And today we are here to meditate upon the theme, "Were you there when Pilate asked Jesus, what is truth?" We are very happy to have Sir Dominic Manning, who is our own church member, who takes a lot of interest in all the activities of our church, particularly in the newsletter that we bring every month. And he is also in charge of the Young Couples Fellowship. And we thank him for all that he is able to do in this church and all the work that he helps. I'm also thankful to him for accepting this responsibility of bringing God's word to us this evening. And I request him to bring and share the word of God with all of us. All the thing, what are you there? When Bible asked Jesus, what is truth?
Let's pause for a moment and ask God direction for this devotion. Through the written word and the spoken word, may we know your living word, Jesus Christ our Savior. In a recently televised devotional, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Reverend Justin Welby, said, God gives us hope in normal times and resilience in times of crisis. God gives us hope in normal times and resilience in times of crisis. We are living in a very critical moment of human history, where technology has failed. Everything that we knew of has failed us. The only option is looking up to heaven for answers. During this year's Lenten meditation in our church, we are going back in history and putting ourselves in that situation by asking several questions. The theme for today's meditation is, were you there when Pilate asked Jesus, what is truth? The scripture portion is already read for us. Truth is a key component of Christian faith. In fact, Bible presents Jesus as truth personified. Jesus is the personification of truth, is what scripture teaches us. A writer of Proverbs writes of truth poetically by saying, buy the truth and do not sell it. Wisdom, instruction and insights as well. Proverbs 23 and verse 22. It is written poetically, it does not really mean we can buy truth. We can just live truth. Jesus was born in a very complicated situation. Power politics and economics were normal norms. The region where Jesus was born had two different powers. The Roman Emperor represented the military power. He had stationed a governor there in Judea. Herod the Great, appointed by Romans as the king of Jews, represented civilian power. Herod the Great was a very well-connected person. He had built several structures in and around Judea. He had the power and authority to decide on tax, collect tax, and remit it with the Roman authorities. By doing so, he had become very rich and popular. His decisions were always backed by Roman government. He was very creative in generating resources, generating tax for his kingdom. He had nationalized several natural resources. Through it, he was collecting taxes. Because of this, he was well connected in Rome also. Jesus was born in this kind of a situation. Jesus was born in Bethlehem, a small town on the outskirts of Jerusalem. Just 3 kilometers away from that place, Herod had built a beautiful structure called Herodian. This was a fortified palace which had all luxuries and represented power. Even today, if we visit Bethlehem, Herodian is visible from the place of Jesus' birth. In contrast to this power, Jesus was born powerless. He was completely defenseless. Jesus was born in the shadow of a massive representation of power. Herod was rich, but Jesus was a poor child. Herod was well connected, but the parents of Jesus were poor and not being known by anyone within their own family. Herod personified power, whereas Jesus personified truth. In the later part of Jesus' life and ministry, Jesus himself claimed, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." John chapter 14 and verse 6. Jesus' birth in a place having a clear sign of Herodian was not a coincidence, but divine orchestration. Birth of Jesus can therefore be seen as truth countering power.
Please, and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin. What are we accomplishing?
questioning, they asked, "Here is this man performing many signs. If you let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and then Romans will come and take away both our temple and our nation." They were worried about their power. They felt threatened. Verse 49, "Then one of them named Caiaphas was the high priest that he had spoken. You know nothing at all. You know nothing about this. I have a solution." What is that solution? Eliminate. "I have a solution for this problem of Jesus." What is the solution? Eliminate him. Verse 53 clearly says, "So from that day onwards, they brought him to take his life." Religious leaders run into a problem then. They were able to punish Jesus, but they were unable to execute him. Roman government had seen the fanatic nature of Jews. They were using the scriptures to selectively kill people. So they had barred Jews from executing anyone. Only three categories of people were to be executed under Roman law. People who were tried and convicted for treason. People who were tried and convicted for economic offenses. People who were tried for heinous crimes and convicted. How play is presented to us by John in chapter 18 and 19. That's the reason they take Jesus to Roman governor's presence. Pontius Pilate had two different roles as he served as a governor in that place. To collect taxes through Herod and to keep Jews happy so that there is no revolt. When Jesus is presented before Pilate, Pilate is in a dilemma. He knows Jesus has a large following. Some believe that he is their Messiah. Some believe that he is at least a prophet. If he takes any decision against Jesus, people may revolt. On the other hand, he is also afraid of religious Jews who are powerful, who can write to Rome and call him back. John chapter 18 and 19 gives us the glimpse of this dilemma. He is trying to wriggle out of the situation. Chapter 18, verse 31. Pilate said, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law. If he is guilty of breaking your law, judge him according to your law." But the religious leaders had already come to a conclusion. They wanted to kill Jesus by hook or crook. Very next verse says, "But we have no right to execute anyone," the object. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus replied, is again an astonishing one. "Is that your idea, or did these people who brought me here told us?" By this time, Pilate has already seen how Jesus has marched into Jerusalem as king. Verse 35, Pilate says, "Am I a Jew? Your own people and chief priests handed over to me. What is it you have done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jewish leaders. But now my kingdom is from another place." Pilate says, you are a king then. Answer of Jesus is again a surprising answer.
You said
that, the king. Yes, I'm the king, but for a different reason I was born. I'm a different kind of king altogether. I was born and came into the world to testify the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me. Now comes the classic question. What is truth? What is truth? And even before Jesus could answer that question, Pilate walks off. He went to the Jews and says, I find no basis for charge against. I have come to this conclusion. There is no point in convicting this person. There cannot be any charges against this person. But without taking a decision, Pilate tries to play with this power. He says, in your own tradition, there is a practice to release a convict. There may be many convicts. Jesus is one of them. Barabbas is one of them. There may be other convicts in the list. Pilate picks up the name of Barabbas and says, do you need Barabbas or Jesus? Jews said, we don't need Jesus, we need Barabbas. In chapter 19, we see how Pilate tries to wriggle out of this situation again. He tries to punish Jesus by getting him flogged, thinking that Jews will be happy with this kind of punishment and he can get away with it. As he was flogged, soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They clothed him in purple robe and went up to him again and again, saying, Hail, King of Jews! Slapped him in the face. I thought this was a sufficient punishment for Jesus. Jews will be happy with it. Verse 4 of chapter 19. Once more Pilate came out and said to Jews gathered there, look, I'm bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no basis for the charge against you. When Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to him, here is the man. From verses 6 through to 10, there is a personal turmoil in the life of Pilate. There is a warning from his wife. He is unable to come out of this situation. At one point of time, he wants to save Jesus. Another point of time, he wants to save his saying, when Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid. He went back inside the palace. Where do you come from? He said. He asked Jesus. But Jesus gave him no answer. Do you refuse to speak to me? Pilate said. Don't you realize I have power either to free you or to crucify you? Pilate is stunned by Jesus' answer. Jesus answered, you would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed over to you is guilty of a great sin. Pilate is just saying, my world is a world of power. Power always seeks its own interest. Even when Pilate knew Jesus was not guilty, he ordered the crucifixion of Jesus. He yielded to mob mentality, mob justice. Along with religious leaders, I believe they have got rid of truth. They thought our problem is solved. I may be wondering why there is no uprising. In the beginning verses of chapter 18, we see how Jesus is presented before Pilate in early hours so that people are not their obstacles. Very tricky way in which Jesus is presented before Pilate. Before people could realize what was happening, Jesus is already sentenced. There is no uprising. Religious leaders are happy with this decision. They thought we have solved the problem. Little did they know there will be a resurrection days later. Truth always offends power. Truth always overcomes power. Power tries to use violence against truth, but truth always prevails. Philosopher Francis Bacon, in his essay on truth, wrote, "What is truth?" said jesting Pilate, and would not stay for an answer. Even before Jesus gave an answer, he was crucified. He came face to face with truth, but could not recognize it. He was obsessed with power. 19th century British politician Lord Acton popularized that phrase, "Power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely." This is very much true in the contemporary world. Truth is always threatened by power. Power uses violence against truth. As we come face to face with Jesus during this Lenten devotion, what is our stand? Do we take up truth or do we fall for power? Many of us are tempted to go with power. Little do we know that truth always prevails. The cry of the sages of India is this: Satyameva Jayate, Satyameva Jayate, Satyameva Jayate. It simply means truth prevails, truth prevails, and truth prevails. Scripture clearly teaches us truth always prevails. What is truth then? Jesus is the truth. The truth of God is revealed in the person of Jesus. May we be the people who choose truth over power. Power is temporary. Truth is eternal. Amen.
In the light of the word that we have received, let us now form our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to gather the living in the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This is the time that we come before God to intercede, taking all the concerns of the humanity, concerns of the whole world. Let us at this time remember the whole humanity, the whole world, that is suffering with this pandemic, coronavirus. People suffer, and people die. And there are so many people, there are so many people shedding their tears, mourning at the loss of their dear ones. Let us remember these people. Let us also pray for the doctors and nurses who are working tirelessly, day and night, risking their own lives. Pray to God that God may fill them, that help them, strength them, so that they will be able to serve the patients under their care. There are also people, the scientists and the researchers, who are struggling hard to find the solution. We pray to God that God may give them wisdom so that they will be able to find out the solution at the earliest. We will especially remember at this time for our own country and the people who suffer. Particularly at this time where it is experienced lockdown, the migrant workers are just walking and walking miles of miles without food, without water, without any shelter. They do not have money. They do not have any home. We remember such people in our prayers so that their help comes from the Lord, and God uses the human beings as God's instruments for them to be helped. The whole world is under economic crisis. We do not know what our future is, what it will be. Let us ask God to intervene in this situation, bring healing to the whole world, the whole creation. God has to experience that healing that God gives. We pray for all the leaders of our nation, the leaders of our state, and all those who struggle to keep everyone safe. And we also pray for people so that they have the wisdom and the understanding to cooperate with the decisions of the nation's leaders take. We pray for ourselves, our families, our dear and near ones. We are safe under the care and shelter of our God. We are there to help others as well, because there are so many people around us who are in need of so many things, the basic things they lack. Where do they go? What do? Therefore, let us bring them before our God's throne and seek God's blessings upon them and upon us, so that we become instruments, the hands of God, to help these people apart from evil. And the sum of all our petitions in our Lord's prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ himself, restore us, support, strengthen and establish us. To him be the power forever and ever. May the blessing of God, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit